I would like to welcome you to Haiti and the politics of recovery. And thank you so much for supporting social justice in Haiti as well as the Winnipeg Haiti Solidarity Group. My name is Carmel. I've been with the Winnipeg Haiti Solidarity Group for just over a year. And I really want to welcome you to what is going to be a very special opportunity to get a first-hand account of the situation in Haiti and its poignant history, as well as Canada's role and what we can do to improve things over there. So we have two speakers tonight. Sandy Gessler, just to my right, is a University of Manitoba coordinator and professor at the Faculty of Nursing. She went on a 10-day delegation to Haiti this past June, and she's going to be sharing some of her experiences with us. She's also a social activist in Winnipeg and the current president of the Social Planning Board in Winnipeg. Please welcome Sandra.
The delegation was quite small. It was Roger from the BC chapter of the Canada Haiti Action Network, and he was our leader and organizer, an organizer extraordinaire. If you're ever taking a trip to a troubled country, I suggest you enlist Roger. He was amazing. I actually, try not to ad-lib too much. I would sort of tease him and grumble a bit because he had every minute of our day booked up with enriching, informative experiences. And we made very good use of those brief days that we were there. Another member of our group was a young woman named Rosina George. Rosina grew up in Haiti. And spoke fluent Creole and was very useful because of her background, having grown up there, and her facility with the language. She currently lives in Toronto and works as a language specialist, I believe. And then there's me. And our host in Haiti was a fascinating chap named Tim Swartz. He's a PhD in anthropology. He's been doing research in Haiti and the Dominican for about 25 years, and he's written a couple of books. He also speaks fluent French, Spanish, and Creole. That's what that's the group. That's Rosina and Tim in the middle, and Roger, who's also in the back of the room. And I'm right here. The main purpose was fact-finding, observation, some networking with some local community groups. And for the purpose of bringing that information back to Canada, there's certainly a big concern that Haiti's had a lot of issues and problems for a long time. Any major crisis like an earthquake just multiplies. They're not equipped to deal with a crisis like that, so everything just gets 1,000 times worse for them when they're struck by an earthquake or flooding. And our concern was, and the various sort of political advocacy groups for Haiti, is that after the earthquake, Haiti, it wasn't very long before Haiti went off the radar as far as the media was concerned. And we're hoping to, use our presentations to make people aware that there's still a huge number of problems. And then, in fact, our own government could play a much more positive role than it has been playing. We traveled fairly extensively, but in a fairly tight circle in the middle of Haiti. We saw lots of Port-au-Prince. We spent a lot of time right in the capital, meeting with, as I mentioned, activist groups and organizations. And we also traveled to Laogon, which was actually the epicenter of the earthquake. And we also traveled through the fairly mountainous area to Jacmel, which is on the coast. This is where we stayed, and I'm showing some of these views just to illustrate that, when we think lots of people, because of the typical media coverage, is that Haiti is just sort of all devastation and really poor people living in hovels. There's a very small middle class. And there is, you know, there are office buildings and things that we would, you know, that we would recognize as well. So a lot of what I'm showing are more positive things, just to balance the typical impression that we have of Haiti. So this is Tim's house where we stayed. And every morning when we left Tim's and got into our vehicles, this was our view. And it's probably not the best exposure, but just beyond that fencing is a deep valley, a very a deep green valley with countryside and little farms sort of terraced on the side. And anyway, this doesn't show it really well, but it was a spectacular view. This is where Haiti's located, for anyone who hasn't sort of looked at a map of the Caribbean recently. You can see Cuba is just spitting distance away, and so is Puerto Rico. And the Turks and Caicos are just a little further away. And you can see that the island is divided between the Dominican and just very briefly, a little bit about what Haiti looks like. There's the description. It is a third of the island of Hispaniola with the DR on the other side. Very mountainous, as I mentioned. Very sandy, rocky, gravelly base. Everywhere you go, there's a lot of dust if there's, you know, if the ground has been laid bare because of building or deforestation. Main cities, there are three of them, Port-au-Prince, Cape Haitian, and Jacmel. The next slide, I think, has a map showing the main population centers. The total population is just under 10 million. The median age, very young population, 18 years. 95% of the population, as you can see here, is black, and the rest are white or mulatto, a combination of black and Caucasian. Life expectancy is somewhere in the mid-50s, and I put some comparisons on just to make them a little more meaningful. So in Canada, life expectancy on average, if you put both genders together, is about 78 years, and going up steadily, you know, sort of a year or 6 months at a time, every few years. The U.S. a little less at 75, you can see Japan at 80. All of the things, the epidemiological markers that countries compare themselves on are very poor for Haiti. Their infant mortality rate is quite high. You can see the big difference, 75 infant deaths per 1,000 live births compared to Canada at 5. Just to give you an idea of what the country and the population looks like. And this is a map of Haiti. I hope it's fairly clear. Port-au-Prince is the star in the middle. Cap Haitian is up at the top, and Jacmel down at the bottom. That's what that sandy, rocky terrain looks like if there's no vegetation on it. You can see where all the dust comes from. This is some of the, just another view of some of the hilliness, and you can see the top has been stripped bare. They use the wood for fuel mostly. Typical street scene in Port-au-Prince could have been really in anywhere, but I believe this was Port-au-Prince. You can see it's actually a very pedestrian city, that cars have kind of been the interlopers, so it's a very crowded city because everybody's used to getting around on foot, and the population density is pretty high, and then you cram in a bunch of SUVs and trucks from all the NGOs that have arrived with their vehicles, and it's a very crowded, we frequently were in, what is it when traffic gets absolutely stalled, gridlock. This is some of the stuff, as I say, I found fascinating. I probably put way too much detail on here. The original natives on the island of Hispaniola were the Arawak and Taino. They were devastated by the Spanish landing and setting up on the island, and they were all gone within 20 years. Some books even say it's within 12 years. They were enslaved, they were worked to death, European diseases that they weren't used to, their immune systems weren't used to. So they were gone, and when the Spanish wanted to continue harvesting and using the island for the gain of Spain, That's when they started to import African slaves to work the land for them. In the early 1600s, France then kind of muscled in and they established a base. There was a bit of a tussle between Spain and France for a number of years. And eventually the island was divided up. Interestingly enough, the slaves rose up between those two dates that I won't read out to defeat the Europeans, and they in fact did. In 1804, they declared their independence from France, and they were the first country to actually declare independence from a colonizing country. Once Haiti declared their independence, France continually threatened them with gunboats and invasion and refused to recognize their independence unless Haiti paid a huge reparation fee. And I've heard various things about what it would amount to now. It's like, I don't know, what have you heard, Roger? Like $2 billion, like something outrageous that no developed country could even particularly afford. But if they didn't pay it, France used their influence to have the Brits come in with their gunships and threaten them in the Port-au-Prince Harbor. So Haiti was stuck paying that off, and I believe their last payment was somewhere in the 1970s or something.
1940s.
Oh, okay, I'm way off. 1940s. And then the U.S. started interfering from 1915 to 1934. There actually was an American occupation of Haiti, and all kinds of things were imposed on Haiti that they're still sort of struggling to recover from. A little further along, the Duvaliers came into power. First of all, the father, who was a rather ruthless dictator, and he was followed by his son, who was expelled from the country eventually, and only recently came back. And there's a movement to make him, to have him stand trial and face some legal consequences for the illegal things that he did, fairly vicious illegal things that he did while he had the reins of power. In 1990, this brings us up to the fairly current, Aristide won a large majority in Haiti's first free presidential election. This is a very checkered history, which, by the way, I'm not totally up to in my reading. I just know some of the outline. He was voted in 90, he was ousted in 91, he returned in 94, as you can see here. He established a political party that's very popular, a very social reformist party in Haiti, but it's had all kinds of obstacles, just like Aristide's terms as president. He was elected again in 2000, faced continuing opposition from people that hold the power and the money and the influence in Haiti, and their friends in the U.S., Canada, and France. Aristide was making a number of reforms that really shook up the power establishment, and he was eventually, most of the accounts support the fact that he was basically kidnapped by a small force of Americans and put on a plane and sent to a country in Africa, and where he stayed for 7 years and just recently returned this past spring. The current president of the last round of elections is Michel Martelly, and he really has not yet established anything that would resemble an effective government yet, which adds to Haiti's problems. Initially, Haiti was produced great wealth for France and for Spain early on, and now it's really one of it is the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, all kinds of problems. Some of their basic industries are sugar refining, cement, textiles, flour milling, but these don't really amount to a whole lot of wealth in terms of exports. Most people depend on small-scale farming, and as we mentioned, deforestation is a major concern. They're very dependent on foreign aid, which is never good for any population. The drug trade is huge, so they have an issue with a lot of influence from that quarter. 80% of the country lives in poverty by any definition that you use, and two-thirds really have no formal job with a paycheck at the end of the day or at the end of the week. The diaspora, mostly the educated and skilled, leave Haiti. The bigger populations are in Florida, New York, and Montreal, and we just have a very small Ralph's our diaspora. And 1% of the population, it's funny because I just saw this in the paper about Canada, 1% of our population holds most of the wealth in the country, you know, when you work out the percentages, and that's certainly true. One of the books I read indicated that there have been 5 wealthy families historically that held most of the wealth, and they still do, and they're hanging on to it with every bit of might they can muster. All kinds of problems. Not many kids have access to public education. Health care is difficult to access. Very high unemployment. Housing has been in crisis for forever in Haiti. And every natural disaster that they experience, things just get worse as far as housing goes. Sanitation's an issue, crowding, all of those things. So right down social determinants of health, you nurses in the front, they're all there. Or the social determinants of ill health, they're all there, I guess I should say. The typical diseases are all kinds of food and waterborne illnesses, hepatitis, several different kinds, typhoid fever, dengue fever, as you can see here. Malnutrition is an issue. They actually have a fairly high rate of heart disease as well. And violence and trauma, very high maternal death rates, and as I mentioned before, high infant mortality rates. And AIDS is a big issue, and so is TB. Since the earthquake, you can add to that rather long, dreary list, cholera. As many of you have probably read, because I'm betting most of you have an interest in keeping up on events in Haiti, that it was actually some of the UN forces that were brought in that seem to have been the source of the recent cholera epidemic. And I think so far the count is about 6,000 people have died from cholera, and many more have been ill. We visited or saw many cholera treatment centers. Again, another typical street scene. That's very typical housing that you'd see, sort of in somewhere between the poorest parts of town or the tent encampments and the more middle class part of town. This was meant to illustrate a typical school. You can see it looks like something you might have seen on the Canadian prairies, you know, 150 years ago. There are hospitals in every region, pretty badly equipped, and often with healthcare staff that have pretty meager training. There are a gazillion aid agencies, faith-based organizations, doing bits and pieces, providing some degree of healthcare, but quite uncoordinated as near as we could tell. There were several cholera treatment camps, and against it would be a faith-based organization would set up a cholera treatment camp for a couple of months or 3 months or so, and then they might just pack up their tent and go away when their resources ran out or their staff got tired and wanted to go back home to the U.S. or Canada or wherever they were from. The agencies that are providing good quality health care doggedly in Haiti is certainly Médecins Sans Frontières, who have a pretty good reputation everywhere in the world where they set up. Partners in Health, for sure, led by Paul Farmer, has a great reputation in Haiti and doing some amazing work, and the Cuban Health Brigade as well. I desperately tried to get a handle on nursing education, and we found one school run by a church group, and I believe they have one main medical school. But lots of Haitians interested in medicine go over to Cuba for their education. This is a hospital in Leagon, the center of the earthquake. I'm not putting it up here to necessarily show you the damage. This was a 400-bed hospital, down to about 40 beds because so many wings of the hospital were destabilized enough. They hadn't actually fallen down, but lots of cracks in the walls. Canada and Haiti do go back a long way. We provide a lot of financial aid to Haiti. I found this piece of information somewhere reliable, that next to Afghanistan, so since we've been in Afghanistan, a large chunk of our aid goes there. But prior to that, Haiti was the largest recipient of Canadian aid, and we don't know what it's been going to. I'm sure it's going somewhere, but as they say, we look very hard for any signs of Canadian involvement, and the best we think we found were, well, some volunteer nurses and doctors in some of the camps, and a couple of Canadian military with the UN force, who looked very intimidating in their black jackets and so on. And they weren't very friendly when we said, hey, we're Canadians, and they went, we don't care. Please exit the camp that way. We're not your friends. What we do know is that very often the U.S. and Canada uses their aid as a lever to control what they want Haiti to do or not do. We think that needs some explaining too. And we do know that most of the policies seem to be certainly, you know, out of self-interest, particularly for the American industries that like to produce cheap goods over in Haiti because the minimum wage is so low. Again, the issue of the media doesn't pay all that much attention to Haiti, even though there are a number of things to be outraged about. Even if you just took the Canada-Haiti relations, there are a number of things to be outraged about and demand answers to. So, as I say, that's what we're hoping some of our presentations stimulate. Just another view, I think I'm very close to the end. My big finish. So this is Haiti, very typical scene of the housing. You can see up the hillside. This is Haiti. These are women educators in a school that's partly supported by actually a philanthropic family in Toronto. These women work pretty hard to keep this school going and the students successful. This is Haiti. Isn't that beautiful? It's a scene in Jacmel. Could be a tropical paradise. And this is the future of Haiti. I hope we can help them. And I'll turn it over to Roger.
Thank you so much, Sandy. I just want to introduce Roger to you all. He is a coordinator for the Canada Haiti Action Network and the Vancouver affiliate, which is Haiti Solidarity BC. He is also a frequent writer for the regarding Haiti issues and Canadian government policy. And he also edits the Canada Haiti Action Network website, which is canadahaitiaction.ca. So please welcome Roger. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having Sandy and I here tonight to tell you about our trip. I'm a coordinator of the Canada Haiti Action Network, which is an advocacy network for social justice and sovereignty for Haiti. And we came into existence in 2004, 2005. Following the overthrow of Haiti's elected government that Sandy talked about in her presentation. And we have been advocating for the big powers of the world to allow Haiti to govern itself without interference and to provide Haiti with the meaningful assistance in social and economic development that it is due. It's been a very uphill struggle, and of course everything has been multiplied 10 and 20 and 100 times over by the conditions of the earthquake. What we thought we would see in Haiti is what we saw, which is that the conditions of foreign interference, domination, and prevention of social development in Haiti are reproducing themselves in the new conditions. And so that's the first and most important thing to understand when people say, well, why are we still hearing that things aren't progressing very much in Haiti? And so the events of 2004, which was the second overthrow of elected government in Haiti by the big powers of the world, principally the United States, but increasingly with the support of Europe and Canada, is a very important backdrop to understanding the situation today. It's not old history. It's very much today present in the difficult conditions of attempting to reconstruct Haiti. So that's an important backdrop to keep in mind. I would like to talk to you tonight about the tremendous deeds of heroism that are going on in Haiti, first and foremost by the Haitian people themselves, who are living under extraordinarily difficult conditions, conditions that you and I frankly could not live in. We would die under these conditions. They survive and struggle, and they do have a spirit. They have a hope for the future. It's a hope that they associate with the other peoples of their region, their part of the world, but also the other peoples like themselves who struggle against colonialism and imperialism. And so despite everything we saw, you know, we saw lots of evidence of hope, of courage, of optimism even, if you could say, but it's very measured and it's very difficult. But I do want to stress that at the outset, because most of what I want to present to you tonight is not a happy picture. Things are not progressing very well in Haiti, and there's no sign that they will progress until there's some important political change, above all internationally, but also related to that, to Haiti, and also regionally as well, the Latin American and Caribbean regions. It's all something that has to change fundamentally for progress to be made. But in talking about the difficulties and the obstacles, I don't want to have us overlook the tremendous accomplishments that are happening by the Haitian people, and also by all those people that have come to assist Haiti from around the world, and people like you and I who contributed financially, first of all to help the country survive, but then to begin to develop. Sandy said life is difficult. The one noticeable improvement that was evident was the clearing of the streets of rubble. In most parts of Port-au-Prince that we saw, the rubble that was there for months and months and months following the earthquake has gradually been cleared so that economic activity can resume to some extent. But it's a terrible job of reconstruction. I mean, imagine probably half of these buildings are damaged. How do you get into hillside neighborhoods like this and begin to rebuild houses, or perhaps to reimagine and redevelop entire communities? It's an extremely tough job, and nobody in Haiti thinks that this is going to be done in 6 months or a year or even in 2 years. But what Haitians want to see and are demanding is that a plan and the signs of progress begin to happen more vigorously. And this is typical of what you see as you travel around Port-au-Prince. The signs are evident everywhere, and they're going to remain that way for some period of time yet. This is right in the very downtown, very close to the port of Port-au-Prince. And this really doesn't look much different than it would have a month after the earthquake. Big job to rebuild buildings like that. That may be a public building or it may be private, but either way it's a big job to rebuild a city. There are signs of rebuilding happening. This is kind of a typical housing development happening in this case a well-to-do area. Of course, it's the people with money who can begin to reconstruct and rebuild houses that were damaged or destroyed. And so you see signs like this, but they're small pockets here and there. By no means the overall picture. On the contrary, it's the exception to what you see. And this is the repairing of a structure that was damaged. In this case, this is a project that's initiated by Build Change, wonderful organization, an architectural organization founded by a young American woman that's in Haiti to teach Haitians basic techniques of how to rebuild concrete structures that won't fall down if there's an earthquake next time. But again, you know, this is one little house that we visited in a neighborhood of hundreds and maybe thousands like this. So it's still on a very small scale. And as Sandy showed you, the daily life is tough and difficult. you know, this is the main economic activity in Haiti, which is to take the money that comes into the country, either from the diaspora or from the international aid, and then just try and eke out an existence so you can put food on the table that day. And so every major street in Haiti is just lined with people selling things to. You wonder who they're selling it to, because nobody's got work. The unemployment rate in Haiti is something like 70 or 80%, but somehow an economy persists and people survive. But under very difficult conditions. This is, this photo happened to be taken after the earthquake, but I could have taken a photo like this when I was there in 2007. It's a country that's been made to be poor and underdeveloped, and things have only gotten worse. These are the overall aid figures for Haiti. If you look in the, and this is the report of the UN's Office of the Special Envoy in Haiti, of whom the deputy envoy is Dr. Paul Farmer. And they produced a pretty good report in June 2011. It's definitely a very educational report. It doesn't just go through the facts and figures, but talks about some of the underlying problems that confront Haiti and the world. So the first line is the immediate relief aid. That's the emergency stuff that went in the weeks and a couple of months after the earthquake, $1.7 billion. And the lion's share of that went in those first few months. And that's the life-saving stuff, the food, the medicines, the water, the tents, the other forms of temporary shelter, a lot of the medical aid that went in on an emergency basis. And so when you look in there, you see that 1% of that went to the Haitian government. So right away, there's a sign of who's controlling the resources in Haiti. Five times as much money in the immediate relief effort was spent by the International Red Cross and its various affiliates, including the Canadian Red Cross. So the Red Cross alone, just one agency, has five times the funding of the national government in Haiti that was received. And then the next set of figures are the figures for recovery aid. There was an international conference held in New York City on March 31st, 2010. And at the conference, the world pledged $5.3 billion in recovery aid to Haiti for the years 2010-2011. Additional figures were promised for the years following. So those are just for the 2 years. And of that amount, by the end of this year, it's going to be roughly around 40 to 45% that will have been delivered. So right away, half of the pledges never even got to Haiti. And then the other half, this is the discussion and debate in Haiti. Where are the funds? Where are the $2.1 billion? Well, a lot of it has gone to basically sustain the very infrastructure of the international organizations that are there. So it's indicative of the problem. And this recovery money, one of the difficulties is that the delivery of the money is slowing down over time, and this is a great concern for Haitians. The third figure is the money that charities and NGOs provided to Haiti. It's a separate figure than those other two figures. Those other two figures pertain to governments and to UN agencies. So again, you see that the resources available by the NGOs and charities in Haiti they're actually equal to what the world's governments and UN agencies together provide. And both of those are far, far in excess of what the Haitian government has. So that's the overall picture. You have a weak, underfinanced national government in Haiti that's basically at the disposition of these billions of dollars of international money that are coming in. And finally, the figure for cholera funding, which Sandy said, cholera remains a very serious and ongoing threat to Haiti. Cholera was unknown to the island of Hispaniola until the Nepalese contingent of the UN military force in Haiti arrived in October 2011 and began to dump their sewage into one of the country's largest rivers, the Artibinit River. And so this is a great, great concern about whether the funding for prevention and treatment of cholera is going to continue to come in the way that it's needed. And these are the figures on the basic building infrastructure of the earthquake zone. This is for the city, metropolitan city of Port-au-Prince. This is the only systematic study that was done of the physical condition of the city following the earthquake, and this was the surveying was done at the end of 2010. The report was completed in March of 2011. The report was commissioned by USAID. because it wanted to know how effective were its rubble removal programs. Did they actually assist Haitians in rebuilding houses or neighborhoods? The answer that the report provided was yes, it did. It was necessary and effective programming to do. But in the course of answering that question, they had to find out, well, what is the physical state of the city? And this is what they found out. Almost all of the buildings in Port-au-Prince were surveyed. And of every building in the city, 20% are condemned that cannot be safely lived in, period. Have to be torn down, literally torn down. Another 26% require major structural repair, are not safe to live in, period. So you have half the buildings in the city that are simply unsafe to live in. Far more dangerous than they were prior to this earthquake, should another earthquake happen, heaven forbid. And so this is the part of the study that was most disturbing, the highlighted section I have here. Because what the surveyors found is that despite the danger of the red and yellow-coated buildings, people are moving back into them. And why are they doing that? Because they've lost faith in the shelter and housing program that the international community said it would provide. They're voting with their feet. They would prefer to live, take their chances, in a building that could fall down on them, perhaps even with a tremor, than to continue to live week after week and month after month in the terrible conditions of the survivor camps under scraps of canvas or plastic or what have you, with all of the difficulties that are there. And I think this is why USAID did not want the study published, because it's really a condemnation of the failure of the international community, if I can use that term, but the world's governments, to come to a sufficiently quick and rapid response. Now, nobody in Haiti, no Haitian thinks that they're going to all have a roof over their head in a year or 2 years, maybe not even 4 or 5 years, who knows. But what they do believe is that there is not a robust plan in place that in which they can have some confidence, and maybe they won't have to move back into damaged buildings. At the very least, shelters that protect people from the rain and the winds and the mud and the sewage that flows when the rains overflow the latrines and everything else, at the very least, they expect that after almost 2 years now that the world could have provided this. Now, there's a related part of this study which became its most controversial point, and is really quite secondary to the study. But in doing the surveying in the neighborhoods required to find out what were the conditions of the buildings and who was living where, they came up with an estimate of the death toll from the earthquake, which is approximately a quarter of the official figures that were provided by the Haitian government, and then figures that the UN accepted more or less without question. That is that the death toll is at, by the BAR study here, is estimated to be around 65,000 people, a quarter of the quarter million that the Haitian government. Well, where did the Haitian government get its figures from? Guesstimates on the back of pieces of paper. This was the only study that went into neighborhoods and said, who lived here and where are they now? And I think it's unfortunate that the world's resources can't do something as basic as estimate what was the real physical damage to the Haitian people caused by the earthquake, because there are significant consequences for those numbers, for those figures. Of course, many people feared that if this study with its figure of 65,000 came out, that all of a sudden the world would say, aha, we don't need to provide as much aid funding to Haiti. But frankly, I don't think that's a serious concern. 65,000 people dead from an earthquake is a major, major humanitarian catastrophe, and there's no argument whatsoever to slow down on the aid funding. So we don't really buy that argument. But it's a sign of, you know, too slackadaisical attitude towards having an understanding of exactly what is the challenge now for Haiti. What have Haitians suffered, and what is the challenge for them? Oh, and by the way, this study at the bottom, that's the section of our website on human rights reports. And if you go there, you'll find there's a mountain of human rights reports that have been published on Haiti since the earthquake. It's one of the very impressive things that's been done by international organizations, including a lot of NGOs. Haiti, no one can pretend to not know what's going on in Haiti. If they say that, it's because they're not reading the material that's out there. So you'll find on our website probably the best collection in the English language of the human rights reports that are dealing with all aspects of the situation in Haiti. Now, I mentioned the color coding. There you see, that's a green-coated building. So it's been marked by the surveyors as safe to re-inhabit. That's a yellow code. This is a garage door, but behind that is the house that's suffered major structural damage and not safe to live in. And there's a red-coated building. Now, these are not strictures on whether or not people can re-inhabit their house, as we would probably have in if something similar happened in Canada. We expect the government to take some responsibility, say, no, you can't go in there. It's dangerous for you. We're going to get you rehoused eventually. You know, come and stay in a temporary shelter we provided. All this is a sign to the homeowner, hey, you live there at your own risk. And as I said, people are voting with their feet. Because this is the alternative, the conditions in the camps, which are extremely difficult. We visited about 10 of the camps of survivors of the earthquake. This is the largest. This is Camp Jean-Marie Vincent, which at its height probably had 50,000 people in it. That would be down now to probably somewhere between 30 or 40,000. This is one of the better camps that we saw because it's actually on a what used to be a sports complex. There's a lot of concrete pathways inside, you know, which is a little less bad when it rains. It's not quite as bad as slopping around in mud when it rains, but still the same basic problems of life. It's harsh. The sun's very hot. These structures, you can't be in them during the daytime. It's too hot. There's no jobs. Many of the children are running loose. There's not certainly not enough school space for the children. Medical care is iffy depending on the camp that you live in. Access even to something as simple as clean water or bathing water is very iffy. And you know, a typical structure like this. So we went into the camps to talk to the residents. They were very eager to talk to us because they want us to tell the story to the world because they've heard about the billions of dollars that have been promised. And they're asking, where are the billions? Who's accountable for this? Who's asking the questions in the wealthy countries where the funds are coming from as to what's happened to the funds? What are Canadians asking of their government? Why don't we see the funds here in this part of Port-au-Prince to be building housing and so on? Now, we felt at the same time very very challenged because, you know, we couldn't provide any immediate relief. We weren't the Canadian government. We didn't have a check in our back pocket that was going to solve this in 6 months or a year. All we could do is promise to tell the story here and hope that as more and more Canadians become aware of what the challenges are in Haiti, we can begin to affect policy in Ottawa and see Canada begin to provide more effective aid to Haiti. And so people were very generous with their time and their patience. And I should say that pretty much every one of the camps, they've organized themselves as best they can. They have camp committees that try and look after the major problems that arise around water delivery, security, safety for women, you name it. But the Haitian government needs more resources to run a public health care system, and to date the world has not been providing that. Now, I'm happy to say that in the recent weeks, the Canadian government has announced a new program where it's going to assist child and maternal health care with a total of $20 million for a first year, through a network of existing public and private institutions and also the Cuban Medical Brigade. So it's a good step in the right direction. But Haiti needs a lot more of that from Canada and also from the other governments around the world so that hospitals like this can actually be opening facilities and not barring them like this. And again, this doctor wanted us to tell the story. He said, tell the world what's happening to our fragile and frail healthcare system. We can't even maintain what's there, leave alone think of, you know, building new hospitals and centers. This is the Canadian Red Cross Cholera Treatment Center. It was established in December 2010 amidst much fanfare, and great. It's exactly what Canada is exactly what the Red Cross should be doing. And so we went to visit the site because when I've been trying to follow this story on the Red Cross website, and there's very little information on their website. You literally have to go to Haiti to find out what the Red Cross is doing because it's so poor, the reporting they provide. But I looked in the website and they said, aha, great success. In the month of April, we transferred the operation of our cholera treatment center in Carrefour over to the Haitian Red Cross. And they write, this is a wonderful example of how the Canadian Red Cross works to reinforce Haitian capacity and so on. And so it took us a while, but Tim and I, because this was after Sandy and Rosina had gone back to Canada, we found where the Canadian Red Cross Cholera Center was. And there it is. They closed the center in April. They didn't transfer it to anyone. And we met with Haitians who were there who told us the story. Said, yeah, they came to us in late March, said we're going to close the center in 3 weeks. You know, cholera's gone down, blah, blah, blah. And the Haitians argued with them. We thought we were actually going to be in trouble because the Haitians who were there called up and got one of the Haitian Red Cross officials to drive over and talk to us. We thought, oh my God, the Haitian Red Cross. We go, oh, journalists, get out of here. On the contrary, she wanted to tell us the story. Yeah, we tried to tell them this is wrong. The cholera is by no means gone away. It remains a threat in Carrefour. And in fact, the month after this center was closed, there was a sharp increase in cholera incidents in Carrefour, which is one of the six districts of Haiti. Very poor, tough area, probably almost equal to Cité Soleil. And then we also went and visited a Doctors Without Borders clinic, a cholera treatment clinic, that is very close to this one. And they confirmed the story. Yeah, they decided to close, and you know, they didn't want to get involved. They didn't offer an opinion one way or the other. So when I got back to Canada, I phoned the Red Cross and I said, well, what's the story? What has happened to this center? Did you move it somewhere else? Why did you close it? And I was talking to a media flack who basically said, no, we didn't close the center. It's still there and it's operating. I said, no, you can't talk to me like that. You're insulting me. I was there, but she just couldn't get the point. She either played dumb or really was having trouble understanding. But that was the end of the conversation. Cholera Treatment Center of the Red Cross in Carrefour is doing great, and thank you very much. And then she promised to send me some follow-up information that she never did. But I use this story as an illustration of the difficulty of accountability on the part of so much of the Canadian funding. Go to the CETA website and see for yourself. There's no details there. There's an announcement of a project, we're going to do such and such for women's health, and that's the end. And you'll never see a report a year later saying, aha, here's what we did. Here's what it accomplished. Similarly with the Red Cross. And it's part of the, you know, it's a culture of non-accountability that is perpetrated. And Haiti's not the only victim of this. This is the story of Canadian foreign policy and of CETA. I consider CETA to be a broken, dysfunctional agency. If it does some good things, good, but that's almost an accident in so much of its functioning. On the other hand, there's this. This is Cuba's medical mission to Haiti. And this actually dates before the earthquake, so it would be even expanded compared to this photo. But each of those red dots that you see are medical centers. These are very inaccessible areas. Like, you know, the big international agencies don't go there. It's too hard to get to. It's, you know, you can't set up a big, super high-tech hospital in a situation like that, and yet that's where Cuba goes. And all of this whole system that they have has been reinforced even since the earthquake. It's a tremendous example of international solidarity, but also a model that other countries could follow. Canada is way better equipped than Cuba to do this. So why isn't Canada doing something comparable to this? And I mentioned the Institute for Justice and Democracy in Haiti. This on the left is Mario Joseph, who is the lead attorney of the office in Port-au-Prince, closely attached with the Institute for Justice and Democracy in Haiti. Tremendous work. And this is their office being repaired. Thankfully, it only had light damage, almost cosmetic. So this is one of the times when we visited the office. But the office is a beehive of activity. Women's rights organizations, trade unions, youth, camp residents. This is, you know, the go-to place for a lot of people because some resources are there, not enough. Some legal counsel is there. It's known as a real organizing center for popular organizations. Very important that those of us in Canada find ways to continue to support the work that these folks do because this is empowering Haitian people to be able to stand up for themselves. Oh, and this is a journalist of Haiti Liberté. I'll say a word about that. Very important weekly newspaper. Actually, I was very proud, not proud, I was very pleased to give him that camera because we just had two cameras and I thought, hey, it's better used in Haiti. Now, on the issue of human rights, this is Haiti's number one human rights problem right here. That's Jean-Claude Duvalier, the former dictator of Haiti, who is now comfortably settled once again in Haiti. His return to Haiti was facilitated by France in March of 2011. And he is currently under a certain kind of form of house arrest for financial theft of government funds during the 15 years that he ran Haiti. But there are as yet no charges against him such that he would appear before a court for the massive human rights violations that he was guilty of during his rule, 1971 to 1986. He was overthrown in 1986 by a popular uprising. Thousands of Haitians died under his rule. They went to prison, they were tortured, they were kidnapped and murdered, whatever the case. There was no voice of opposition permitted in Haiti during those 15 years. And both the Haitian justice system today, but also the international justice system, that is the UN court system that we think exists, have not laid a hand on him and said, okay, you're going to trial. We're gonna hear this out in front of judges and courts in Haiti. And part of the problem is that the Haitian justice system itself has very little resources. Haiti's prisons are crammed to the rafters, and 80% of the people in Haiti's prisons have never they've never been condemned of a crime, and they haven't even been charged. 80% preventive detention, that's when they throw you in jail and throw away the key. That's the conditions in Haiti's prisons that have been receiving significant support financially from Canada and also training since 2004 at least. And so this is the justice system that's not able to bring him before a court as yet. People are struggling to make that happen, but we don't know what the outcome will be because it all depends on the goodwill. Now the chief advisor to then Haitian President René Préval came to Ottawa in March of 2010, and I forget the exact date, and he testified before the Foreign Affairs Committee of the Canada's House of Commons. And the principal appeal that he delivered in that testimony was that we need resources to help us prosecute Jean-Claude Duvalier because it's a very expensive process. It involves international laws. It involves Duvalier and his lawyers arguing that there is, what's the word when time runs out on a charge? What's the word? There you go. There's a statute of limitation. Sorry, too long. The man walks free. There is no such thing under international human rights laws, by the way, but so it's not there. And neither Canada nor the United States have given a whit of support to Haiti's justice system to do this. They simply don't talk about it. Have you ever heard anything about this reported in the Canadian media about what the state of affairs is with this, what is, you know, the most important human rights issue right now in Haiti? And it's worse than that. These people are, that is Duvalier supporters, they're flexing their muscles. This is a press conference just, what are we today, Monday, 4 days ago in Port-au-Prince. Amnesty International, which is a little bit late on the issue, but they issued a report last week arguing why the world should take the case of Jean-Claude Duvalier seriously and assist the Haitian justice system to prosecute him. Not to throw him in jail, to have a trial so it can all be aired out. And this is the principal lawyer, Jean-Claude Duvalier, along with 20 of his associates who came to the press conference and broke it up. They shut it down. They shouted, they threatened. And this is one of the Amnesty International campaigners in the photo. This is not just airy-fairy human rights laws. This is, you know, these people start to flex their muscle because they do have a political project in Haiti. Maybe not Duvalier. He's old. Maybe he wants to retire. Who knows? But all of the people that are supporting him, yeah, they want the Haiti that they used to have. And if they're allowed to walk scot-free, if he is allowed to walk scot-free, this is more and more of what we're going to see. That's why there's big stakes involved in this. I don't have time to talk about the agricultural situation in Haiti, but it's very important. And we had a very informative couple of hours with the leaders of Haiti's principal peasant rights organization. I'll just say quickly that they told us that despite all the good words and the good promises that we were going to rebuild the new Haiti, beginning with its agricultural economy, it's not happening. We're having to bang on the door of the government to even be heard, leave alone to be part of any policy-making process. This is another of the important reports. This one is dealing specifically with the issue of governance in Haiti. Michel Martelly was brought to the Haitian presidency through a process that many Haitians call a selection, not an election. or they call it a selection election. But it was an electoral process in November 2010, March 2011, in which less than 25% of the Haitian people voted. Why? Not because they don't want to vote. It's because their choices were ruled off the ballot, including the party of Jean-Bertrand Aristide, Famille Lavalas, banned from participating in the election. And so you have, in Martelly, a dysfunctional presidency that in 6 months has failed to actually create a government. There's no cabinet in Haiti. There's no minister of housing in Haiti with 600 people living in tent camps. There's no minister of health with cholera raging in the country because he can't get his right-wing nominee for prime minister approved by the Haitian parliament. Now, there's been recent progress on this, and basically an assistant of Bill Clinton, the former U.S. president, who is of origin in Haiti but hasn't lived in Haiti for years, it now appears that he will be approved as prime minister by Haiti's parliament and senate. And then he has to now go out and form a government, which will then, more than 6 months later now, actually begin to sit down and hopefully, maybe, probably not, elaborate a real plan that Haitians can get to work on. But this is a major problem with basic governance in Haiti. So that's a major problem. And that's that major problem here on the right symbolized Michel Martelly. Another big problem in Haiti is on the left of the photo, not in the political realm. Bill Clinton holds more of the purse strings in Haiti than does Michel Martelly. Clinton is the head of the Reconstruction Commission. That's the body that makes the major decisions of what happens with those billions of dollars of international money. This is not a Haitian commission that's deciding the future of the country. It's above all Clinton. And yes, he tries to make it look like it's a consultative process and so on. But Clinton's policies and those of all of his cohorts are really the same failed economic policies that got Haiti into problems in the first place. That is an over-reliant dependence on foreign sweatshop factory investment in Haiti as the economic future of the country. This is another big problem in Haiti. This is a map of the larger NGOs. This is actually a small selection. There are something like 10,000 NGOs operating in Haiti. Many of them do good works and they're there with good intentions, but this is what, you know, the Haitian government has to confront, because they have way more money than the government does. It's a major problem in deciding and elaborating policy. And finally this, which is a 12,000 person UN police and military force. There's no war in Haiti. There's no civil war. There's no civil conflict. There's no religious dispute among groups. These are the people here to basically keep the lid on everything that the overthrow of elected government in 2004 was intended to accomplish. And so there's a major debate now in Latin America among the participating countries. Why are we there in the first place? Whose bidding are we doing by participating in MINUSTAH? And we need more discussion that pushes for the withdrawal of MINUSTAH from Haiti and the reestablishment of Haitian sovereignty. And I don't have time to talk about Canada's mission to Haiti. The military mission that went to Haiti for 2 months after the earthquake. If you go to the website, you can read an article I wrote called Exaggerated Claims. And it's based on my attendance at a public forum in Vancouver in October 2010, where one of the commanders of these two warships that sailed for Haiti less than 48 hours after the earthquake, she talked about what they did in Haiti. And I can only, because of time, tell you it wasn't a whole lot. And they pulled out within 6 weeks. This is Canada opening a new prison in Haiti. The Canadian government has said our fundamental priority in Haiti is to assist in the creation of security, what they call, and that is the equipping training of police and prisons. Not the justice system, so that judges can fairly try people in a quick way and get all these preventive detentions out of the jails. No, build the jails and pay the salaries of the police. And what happens in the jails? Hey, that's Haiti's problem, not ours. And it's a policy that has to end. Canada's funding should be going to social and economic development, not to a police system. That's the job of the Haitians, to police themselves. And Canada's policy in Haiti is not unlike its policy in Honduras. This is the president of Honduras, who was the product of a very similar kind of selection election in Honduras last year. But I'm going to end on this note because I've spoken long enough and longer than I should have. This is what we invite you to do. You can also join the Winnipeg Haiti Solidarity Committee here in Winnipeg Haiti Solidarity Group here in Winnipeg. And I'm not in Vancouver, yes, I'm in Winnipeg. And I'll let Ralph say a few words to you. So thanks for your patience. Thank you.